Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Bethany Congregational Church. Thank you for joining us this morning to worship our Lord. I also want to thank those who are watching on Zoom or Facebook. We appreciate you joining us. We know you have a lot of options, so thank you. And if you're ever in Santa Barbara or near here on a Sunday, please come join us. We'd love to meet you in person and join you in fellowship. And I also want to thank those who came to help decorate the church. It looks very festive. Thank you very much. And I want to thank Chuck and Jan for picking up our beautiful tree here. So let's give them a hand, in fact. Okay, so at this time, we're going to be lighting the Advent candles. And Agnes is going to help out. So for today, it's the candle of joy. You can light the first one. Jesus came into this world to bring us joy. The angel said to the shepherds, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. Until now you have asked nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive, that your joy may be full." And so we're lighting the pink candle today of joy. Okay, on to our announcements. They're located on the third page of the bulletin, so if you want to kind of read along. I mean, I am going to talk about a few of them. After church today, we're going to have our vote to approve the 2022 church budget. So we ask that all members stay in after the benediction so that we can take that vote. And for non-members who are interested, please stay. You're welcome to learn more about Bethany and how we run. So please stay too. And then those who are interested in caroling, next Saturday, two Saturdays, December 18th, we're getting a group together to go caroling. We'll meet at the church at 4:30. And if you're interested, please talk to Pastor Chuck or Pastor Marco if you'd like to join that group. And don't worry if you don't sing well. I think God is very forgiving, so please join us. And then December 19th will be our Christmas service, so please join us for that too. And finally, we are continuing to collect donations for the backpacks. And as you know, they'll be used for Christmas gifts for the Santa Barbara Mission. And they're very appreciated there. So if you feel led, please donate there. And now I'd like to call up Pastor Chuck to introduce our missionary for prayer this week.
If Melanie could join me. Melanie Chow is here from GEMS, and she's one of the missionaries that we support, and I just wanted to let her share a little bit of information. If you could tell us, how long have you been with GEMS?
This is my 34th year serving with GEMS on the college campuses.
Wow, 34 years.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. And how many schools are you supervising with AACF?
As a whole, for our ministry, we're on 16 campuses. But for me, I'm overseeing two. So I care for the unstaffed campuses, Davis currently, and Santa Barbara.
Hmm. And the Santa Barbara group, how often are they meeting, and how many students are coming now?
For both campuses, we have seen a wonderful increase of students interested in their faith on campus. So last year, we were able to maintain and keep about 30 to 40 students online through Zoom. But this year, they've been having about 40 to 50. When they have snacks, they have 50. When they have Jesus, we'll see what happens. But they've been increasing, so we are very thankful that people are out there. We had our first week of winter retreat registration. Lord willing, we'll be going to San Marcos in early January, but there were 30 people in 1 week registered, so we're excited.
So you go to San Marcos for what is that again?
The student winter retreat.
Oh, student retreat.
Yeah, weekend always affords a really wonderful time for students to get to know each other better and get to know Jesus, and so they get together. They can't wait. They've waited since 2019 was the last retreat together. So.
Oh, right.
So the seniors who have been involved, they're like, no, we have to have a retreat this year. So we'll see what happens. We'll pray.
Yeah. And is there anything else we can pray for you about?
I think for me, I'm really thankful for the opportunity to do this, to be able to go to the campuses. I think after being in lockdown at home quite a bit, the ability to go to Davis once a month and then to come to Santa Barbara once or twice a month is a real blessing for me to get out of my house. But also, I know that that has caused anxiousness and challenge for parents as well as students and even the professors. I have such a greater appreciation for those who are professors because it's just been really stressful with having to prepare, having to have finals. Especially I know the anxiety that came after Thanksgiving with the students going away and then coming back and COVID numbers rising. So
yeah.
Continuing to pray for health and safety, I think that's probably the biggest concern for the winter retreats. And unfortunately, I'm trying to decide, that's probably the good discernment that I need all along, is what to do on the weekend of Martin Luther King weekend, because both of the campuses that I oversee have retreats. They're a little bit, they start early and they start end, so the option is, if the weather is good, to drive, to spend a few days at the Santa Barbara one, and then to drive up to the Davis one.
Oh, okay.
So I'm not sure, so I'm praying and asking for discernment, so that's probably the best thing, and so I think that's the biggest overarching picture, is how to pray for discernment in this time of how to go, how to come, how
yeah.
to care for the students, how would they discern and get help as well.
Okay, great. Well, you join me in prayer for Melanie? Yeah. Lord, we thank you so much for the ministry of AACF and the ministry that Melanie has with these students. Thank you for this good turnout this year at UCSB with 40 to 50 students coming out. And we pray, Lord, that they will have a blessed time of retreat for the first time in 2 years. And we pray, Lord, that you would give her discernment about her plans for meeting with these two groups, and that you give her wisdom about plans for meetings and for transportation. And we pray also that you would protect her, and that you would also provide for all of her needs, and that you would especially bring students who don't know you into your kingdom through these missions outreaches. So Lord, we pray your great blessing upon these ministries and upon Melanie. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
I also wanted to say thank you for your generosity.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you for your generosity to support me. It means a lot to know that there's a church that prays regularly and to be able to stand alongside the ministry. We also want to encourage students to try and come and visit the church. I know that it's been challenging just to get settled. And so they loved Pastor Derek and Pastor Chuck when they came to visit, but also for you to get to meet them. But I'm looking forward. I'm going to run over to the Nichigo service and then come back, because I think all of us need to hear Pastor Chuck's message on choosing joy in this challenging time.
Oh, thank you. You know, we had a Chinese student over for Thanksgiving dinner this year, and he's a grad student, or he's waiting to get into grad school. He's graduated, And I said, you've been in ACF for 4 years? And he said, yeah, I remember when you came and spoke and told us about the fire in your house in Japan. So I was impressed that he remembered that. So I'll turn it back to Bob. Okay. And he's going to share back in Nichigo now.
Thank you, Melanie, and we definitely will be praying for her. At this time, are there any prayer requests or praises from the congregation? Jean. For those of you who couldn't hear that, Jean was sharing about Lillian Ball and that she's doing well, but to continue praying for her. And so we thank you for that. So please join me in a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day that we can come and worship you freely. Help us never to take that for granted, Lord. We praise and worship you for who you are. We thank you for Melanie Chow, and we lift up the prayers for her, Lord. Continue to bless her family and her ministry. We also want to lift up the many prayers that we have listed in our bulletin, Lord. We know that you know our needs, and we know that you know our unspoken prayer requests too, Lord. I want to lift up Lillian Ball to you and pray that you would continue to heal her, Lord. We thank you that she is doing well and that you are with her, Lord. We pray you answer these prayers, Lord, and we thank you for them. Lord, we know that you want the best for us. Help us trust you for all things, the big ones and the little ones, Lord. Father, I also lift up our tithes and offerings to you. We pray that they will be used to glorify you, Lord. Lord, I lift up this service to you. Give Pastor Chuck the words you want us to hear. And Holy Spirit, open our hearts so we may truly, truly listen and learn more about you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So as the worship team comes up, please greet those near you and say good morning.
Well, as was shared in the Advent lighting. Last week we celebrated hope, and this week it's joy. I hope you have some joy. If you don't, I hope these songs will bring a little joy to you. So please stand and join us in singing well-known carol, Joy to the World.
And heaven and nature sing, and heaven. want to sing a song that I first heard last year on the radio, the Hallelujah second chord with words for Christmas. And so Hallelujah, of course, means praise the Lord. So let's praise the Lord as we sing through the Christmas story.
I've heard about this baby boy who's come to earth to bring us joy, and I just want to sing this song to you. It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. With every breath I'm singing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. A couple came to Bethlehem, expecting child, they searched the inn to find a place, for you were coming soon. There was no room for them to stay, so in a manger filled with it, God's only Son was born. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
And now another favorite Christmas song, Mary, Did You Know? Mysterious and miraculous, and nothing is impossible for you. So we are just filled with joy at what you did 2,000 years ago to come to earth as a baby. And Lord, we worship you today. Ask your blessing on the rest of our service today. We worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated. Now we will partake of communion. Pardon? Communion is open to everyone, and we have elements are both the normal juice with a wafer underneath, or the prepackaged juice and wafers. And so anyone who has put their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus is invited to partake in communion with us.
Let me just read from 1 Corinthians 11. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So if the ushers could come forward, and we will serve. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for the remembrance of what you did, how you sacrificed your body for us. Lord, how you took the penalty for our sins and you took the shame and you suffered on our behalf. And then you rose from the dead and conquered death. And we just thank you, Lord, for the new covenant that you have prepared for us. Lord, I also pray that you would just help us to cleanse our hearts and bring to mind anything that we need to just confess to you and ask your forgiveness. And if there are any brothers and sisters that we need to reconcile with, that you would guide us to do that and lead us and speak to our hearts about that. So, Lord, prepare our hearts as we take part in this Holy Communion. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. On the bottom cup, if you have the two cup or peel off the top of the prepackaged one for the bread, at the beginning of the meal, the Lord said, "Take and eat, this is my body, which was broken for you. And do this in remembrance of me." Then if you have the prepackaged, peel off the next layer and take the cup. And at the end of the meal, the Passover meal, the Lord took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So let's drink. Lord, we thank you for the new covenant, that if we put our faith and trust in you, believe that you died for us on the cross and that you were raised from the dead, we will spend eternity with you and be forgiven of our sins. Thank you, Lord, for that promise, for that covenant. And we celebrate your incarnation to earth this month, and we celebrate what you did for us every Sunday. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right.
Our scripture verse for today is from 2 Chronicles chapter 30, verses 23 through 27. And it says, "Then the whole assembly agreed together to keep the feast for another 7 days. So they kept it for another 7 days with gladness. For Hezekiah of Judah gave the assembly 1,000 bulls and 7,000 sheep for offerings. And the princes gave the assembly 1,000 bulls and 10,000 sheep. And the priests consecrated themselves in great numbers. The whole assembly of Judah and the priests and the Levites and the whole assembly that came out of Israel, and the sojourners who came out of the land of Israel, and the sojourners who lived in Judah rejoiced. There was great joy in Jerusalem, for since the time of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, there had been nothing like this in Jerusalem. Then the priests and the Levites arose and blessed the people, and their voice was heard, and their prayer came to his holy habitation in heaven." May God bless the reading of his word.
Thank you, Bob. And you may have noticed we have one projector not working, but we got the center one working, got the new lamp and the lift and put it in, but then another element was out besides the lamp, so we robbed Peter to pay Paul, as they say, and put the repair up there, and hopefully in another week we'll have all three projectors going. But that's kind of a bit about how my week's been going. This was a difficult sermon for me to prepare because this week sometimes things didn't go as I wanted them to. There was times of frustration. Have you ever had that where you plan on one thing to happen and then things kind of fall apart and the wheels come off, and or you get tired and you get cranky. Yes. Now Jan will tell you, I never get cranky, but you don't believe that, right? And the Lord kept telling me to remember that joy is a choice, you know, but happiness sometimes is not. Happiness, remember, is based on happenings. And so happiness comes and goes, but joy is a command in the Bible, rejoice always. So we should be able to choose joy. But we're happy when things go well. I know that Sagumi-san is happy today because Alabama won their football game yesterday. And if you get a good report from the doctor, you're happy. You know, when things go well, you're happy. But joy is defined as it's a deeper level. It's a sense of well-being, a sense of being loved, that feeling you get when you're with people that you have a mutual love for and you just enjoy being together. That is a difference between joy and happiness. But I realized this week that you can actually choose, you can choose happiness too. If you just choose to look at something that maybe makes you laugh. So I found a few old newspaper headlines, illiteracy and obstacle study finds. So, misspelled obstacle. And then I like this one, Meathead resigns. This was the head of the federal agency overseeing meat and poultry inspections. Would you like that for a job title, the Meathead? My favorite, hospitals resort to hiring doctors. When all else fails at a hospital, you know, let's get some doctors. Then the smaller print says, physician shortage prompting the move. So maybe hiring more doctors would have been a better headline. But that just shows, we can choose happiness to a point, but as I read through this passage, and I was looking for joy passages in the Bible, I thought, why was this special? Why did they have exceeding joy, and why was this the biggest celebration since the time of Solomon when they were having this Passover celebration? And so I had to look at the context of the passage and look back to see why that they were having so much joy. The people in the time of Hezekiah, they knew how to celebrate. They not only celebrated for 7 days, they decided to extend it for 14. Now, have you ever been to a 14-day party? Have you ever celebrated for 14 days? It made me kind of think about vacation when we were working with Christar full-time. One of the things they wanted us to do was to take 2 vacations a year, and they wanted us to make each one at least 14 days. Because research had shown that when you take a vacation, have you ever taken a vacation, and when you come home, you feel like you need a vacation from your vacation? Had that feeling? Well, a real vacation, the first week, you need to kind of unwind and just get over the stress of the everyday life or your work, whatever might be stressing you out. And then you need another week to just kind of rejuvenate. So you need the 1 week to wind down and the second week to rejuvenate. And so that's why a 14-day vacation will rest you and rejuvenate you a lot more than a 1 week vacation. So Israel did a 14-day celebration. But I wanted to find out why was this such a big celebration? So looking at the context, I had to go back to 2 chapters back to Hezekiah's father was King Ahaz. And King Ahaz was what they called an evil king. He did not do what was right in the eyes of the Lord. King Ahaz became king at the age of 20. And in 743 BC, and just want to look at the map of Israel. This shows the tribes and the surrounding countries during the time of Ahaz and Hezekiah. But Ahaz was so evil that he made metal idols for worshiping Baal. Then he cast some of his own sons into the fire, the sacrifice to the god of Baal. And Hezekiah was his son, so Hezekiah was fortunate that he wasn't one that was sacrificed in the fire. So after this, God allowed Syria and Assyria and even northern Israel to attack Judah. Now, if you look at, if you remember your history of the Old Testament, the southern kingdom was called Judah, and it basically was the tribes of Judah and Benjamin, and Simeon kind of was enveloped into Judah. So this was the southern kingdom, or called Judah, and all these other tribes were called the northern kingdom, or was also referred to as Israel. So Israel and Judah, or northern kingdom and southern kingdom. And so Syria and Assyria were up here, and they attacked Judah, they attacked northern kingdom, and then they attacked the southern kingdom. And then the Moabites, Edomites, and Philistines also were attacking them. It was because God took away his protection because they had fallen into idolatry. And Ahaz, brilliant man that he was, being sarcastic, but he said to himself, well, the gods of Syria must be stronger than the God of Israel, so I'll just sacrifice to the Syrian gods instead of the gods of Israel. Because he was doing both. They had the temple worship, and then they had all these idols set up around, and they were just worshiping both. And he decided, well, he'll just worship the Syrian gods. And so he literally boarded up the doors to the temple, shut down the temple operation completely, and built up idols to the Syrian gods around Israel and Judah. Needless to say, God became more angry rather than less angry, and he let all these enemies surrounding Judah attack them. And so then he died, and when he died, the temple was still boarded up, and they had all these idols to Baal around in Israel. And I thought about that. It would be like me coming here to the church on Saturday and just boarding it all up and setting up a Buddhist temple and a Shinto shrine in the parking lot. You know, that, as terrible as that sounds, I mean, that is what he did, only worse. And so his son comes along, and amazingly, Hezekiah did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. And he became king at age 25. And his first year as king, he opened up the temple. He gathered the priests and the Levites back, and he said, we're going to clean out this temple. We are going to rededicate the temple to the Lord. And he cleansed it, and they went through a time of sacrifice. Normally, the sin offering was one bull or one lamb, but they did seven bulls, seven rams, seven lambs, and seven goats as a sin offering to kind of make up for all the sins of Israel that have been going on for years and years. And they cleansed the temple and rededicated it. And this symbol, seven, is also kind of a symbol of completeness. So they really wanted to totally purify the temple after what after his father had desecrated it. And so then, after they did this cleansing and dedication, then he gathered all the Levites, it says in here. And the Levites were the ones who took care of the temple, and they were also the ones who were the worship teams. And so he had them playing cymbals and harps and lyres and other stringed instruments. And then he had the priests have the trumpets, and then all the people gathered, and they sang the songs of David, it says in the in 2 Chronicles 29. And so they had this great celebration and worship time, and they kept praising the Lord until all of these offerings had been burned up on the altar. And this was all part of the celebration of just coming back to the Lord. And then Hezekiah sent letters out to not only all the people in Judah and Benjamin, the southern kingdom, but he sent people out to the northern kingdom. And the northern kingdom had attacked the southern kingdom during his father's reign. They had taken thousands of captives to northern Israel, but then they had released those captives later on. But still, they were kind of like North and South Korea. I mean, they had a truce, but they were not united. They were still technically at war with each other. But Hezekiah sent couriers throughout all of these tribes and invited them to celebrate the Passover because they hadn't been celebrating the Passover. And I thought it was appropriate for this Sunday, because we're celebrating communion. You know, communion is kind of the fulfillment of the Passover. Jesus dying on the cross, Jesus was the Passover lamb that saved us. And so the Passover was really the most important. It was the first festival of the year. They were supposed to do it in the first month of the year, the first week. And they hadn't been celebrating Passover for a long time. It would be like if we just kind of let communion go by the wayside and somebody would say, hey, you know, we haven't celebrated communion in 3 years here. That's kind of what it was like when Hezekiah came. And so they decided, we're not only going to celebrate Passover, we're going to invite all the tribes to come to the temple. Because Northern Kingdom had set up their own idols. They had set up their own worship place on Mount Gerizim. And so Hezekiah was really basically telling the people to come back, let's reconcile and let's celebrate the Passover together. And what he sent out, it's printed on your little insert if you're taking notes. But he said, do not be stiff-necked. Let me see, I've got it here. Yeah. Do not be stiff-necked as your fathers were, but yield yourselves to the Lord and come to his sanctuary, which he has consecrated forever, and serve the Lord your God, that his fierce anger may turn away from you. For if you return to the Lord, your brothers and your children will find compassion with their captors and return to this land. For the Lord your God is gracious and merciful and will not turn away his face from you if you return to him. So he invited all these people from all over both kingdoms, and it says in the Bible that he sent couriers throughout the northern kingdom and Judah, and they were laughed at, scorned, and mocked by most of the people. Yet the Bible says that there were people from Asher, Manasseh, and Zebulun that humbled themselves and came to Jerusalem. So look at that map again. So way up here, Asher and Zebulun and Manasseh, people came from those three tribal areas down to celebrate Passover with those people of Judah. And when they came for Passover, remember, each family sacrificed a lamb at Passover time. And then they would celebrate for a week. But there was such joy that they decided to celebrate for another week. And so I studied about, so why was there so much joy? And thinking back to this history, what I came up with is they had joy because they had done repentance and a consecration, or like a rededication and reconciliation. First of all, the repentance, of course, was when they realized that the idolatry was wrong. And so I didn't mention, but they went around all of Judah and they destroyed all the idols and the other altars that Ahaz had set up. And so they repented of their previous idolatry. And then they consecrated or rededicated themselves to the Lord. And I think there's great joy when we realize that we have either done something we shouldn't have done, or we've been not doing something that we should have been doing, and we come back to the Lord And we not only ask for forgiveness, that's the repentance part where we say, I'm not going to do that anymore, or I'm going to start spending time with the Lord like I used to. That's the repentance. But then that consecration, like what they did rededicating the temple, the consecration is defined as dedicating something to a purpose or a facility. And so they were dedicating themselves to the Lord and to the temple worship. So I had to think, have I really dedicated myself, rededicated myself? If you feel like maybe you've drifted away from the Lord in some area, or you're not just totally dedicated to serving the Lord, that you won't have joy. But when you do repent and you come back to the Lord and you get your forgiveness and you rededicate yourself to the Lord, that brings joy. And then, of course, reconciliation brings joy. When these people from northern and southern Israel got together and celebrated Passover, they had so much joy, they went for 14 days. And basically, when Hezekiah invited them all, he was telling them, you're forgiven. We know you attacked us, you took some of our people captives, but we want to forgive you and reconcile with you. Let's worship the Lord together. And so when you reconcile with somebody, it really brings joy. I've been through many reconciliations. The earliest one I can remember is in Boy Scouts, and I can't remember if I've shared this story or not, but some people would find it hard to believe that I was a Boy Scout as a kid, because I wasn't the most sweetest kid on the block. But I was in Boy Scouts, and I actually got into more trouble in Boy Scouts than some of my other activities. But I got into a fight with the scoutmaster's son, and we just couldn't stand each other. And every time there was a scout meeting, we'd either argue or we'd stay in opposite ends of the room. And so it came time for summer camp, and the scoutmaster carpooled everybody, and he said to Chuck, you're going with me and my son and another kid in my car to the summer camp. And he stuck me and his son in the back seat. And at first we didn't talk to each other, and then we exchanged a few nasty things with each other. But it was like a two-hour ride to this camp. By the time we got to the camp, we were best buddies again. And we just had a great time at the camp. And I remember just having a lot of fun at that camp. And I know that that inner bitterness was keeping me from having joy at that time. And so I think when the Bible says joy is a choice, rejoice always, sometimes there are things we have to do so that we can have the joy, because we might have the joy killers going on in our life. And thinking about these three things, these joy killers, one would be forgetting what the Lord has done. I don't think anyone here has forgotten what the Lord has done, but maybe sometimes we just take for granted what the Lord has done, and we're not as thankful as we should be for what the Lord has done, and really think about what the Lord has done. That's why I think it's good to watch these movies about the life of Jesus, and I highly recommend The Chosen that I've mentioned before. But when you watch these enactments of what Jesus did for us, I mean, it helps me to remember what Jesus has done and not take for granted and catch myself when I start complaining about the little happenings that I don't like in my life, like last week when things didn't go right when I wanted them to, and when I burned the ribs on the barbecue and melted my light on the barbecue, it got so hot. It was just one of those weeks when things didn't go right, but then I had to remember, this is really small potatoes in the big scheme of things, and what Jesus did for me hasn't changed. And it was a great reminder to just go. Thursday night, Jan and I went to the theater to see the Chosen Christmas special, and there was just a lot of great Christmas music, and then a dramatization of the birth of Jesus in Bethlehem, and it was just something that just brought joy, no matter what your circumstances were. You couldn't sit there and watch that and not have joy at remembering what Mary and Joseph went through and what the Lord went through for us. And then fellowship. If some people have kind of gotten out of the habit of attending church and or small groups, or and they don't have that fellowship with other believers, and a lot of it's not by their choice because of COVID. We were all forced to separate for a time, but other people have just chosen not to fellowship because they were church burned or upset with something that happened, or some hypocrites or insensitive Christians just got them angry and frustrated. And so when you're separated from fellowship, I think it's a joy killer. And when you reenact fellowship, when you really spend quality, good times of fellowship with fellow believers, it helps you to restore that joy and helps you to choose joy. And if you have some kind of relationship that needs forgiveness and reconciliation, when you do that, I guarantee that it will bring joy. And so I want to end on a positive note. I know I've talking about things that may be causing you to not have joy. And so I want to choose to be happy again. So I have one more cartoon. This is one of my favorite Christmas ones. He says, "I told you frankincense." And he brought Frankenstein. So he didn't make it to the wise men level. So sorry about that, but finally, I just want to summarize with joy. Remember, joy, the acrostic for joy: Jesus, others, and yourself. Since joy is a command, just remember to choose Jesus first. Remember what he's done for you on the cross. Remember what he continues to do for you every day, every minute of the day. Remember he's always with you and never forsake you. I recommend reading things like Psalm 103. It says, "Forget none of his benefits. He forgives all your iniquity. He heals all your diseases. He redeems your life from the pit. He crowns you with steadfast love and mercy. He satisfies you with good so that your life is renewed with the eagles." And just be thankful for Jesus. And then putting others before yourself, make it a point to serve others, to give others your time, talent, your money, your gifts. Spend quality time with other people. And we've had some neat quality time with fellow believers this week, and that's just been a real blessing to Jan and I. And be thankful. Be thankful for your fellow brothers and sisters. And then yourself. I've talked about this in other messages, but you need to take care of yourself. One reason you might not have joy is if you're just too run down, too tired, too stressed, and maybe you need a Sabbath rest, need some recreation, some exercise, or a vacation, and maybe you just need to sit down and spend quality time with the Lord. So I would just say, if you want to have joy, put Jesus first. And if there's anything that's, if you've drifted away, if I know you haven't fallen into idolatry, but like Ahaz, but you may have just drifted away and you know you need to come back and you know you need to rededicate and reconsecrate yourself to the Lord and to a group of believers and decide, I'm going to serve these people. And then take care of yourself. Things can get crazy, hectic, and too busy during this season, and so it's important that we just take care of ourselves and get rested. So with that, if you feel like maybe you need to repent and rededicate to the Lord, we're going to just pray now. And if you feel like you want to tell the Lord, okay, Lord, I'm coming back to you to do whatever you want me to do, then, you know, just raise your hand and I'll pray specifically for you. But please just bow your heads and let's pray together. Lord, we want to choose joy. And Lord, we know that maybe we have some joy killers in our life. And so, Lord, would you please just cleanse us, bring to mind anything that's displeasing to you so that we can repent of that and put it out of our lives. And if we're neglecting to do something that we should be doing, Lord, please bring that to mind so that we can get right with you and come back to you. And Lord, we want to dedicate ourselves to you. We want to put our entire faith and trust in you. We want to come back to you and just do whatever you want us to do, Lord. So, Lord, we dedicate ourselves to you and to your service, and we dedicate ourselves to our brothers and sisters to serve them and to provide for them and to pray for them. And, Lord, and also our bodies are your temple, temple of your Holy Spirit. And, Lord, we want to be good caregivers of our own bodies and spirits and spend that quality time with you too. So Lord, I pray that each one here will experience the joy that only you can give during this Christmas season. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, we're gonna sing two joy songs and then have our short business meeting. If you'd like to stand and sing with us, How Great Our Joy. Oh yeah, men and women. The men will sing the first refrain in the chorus, and then the women will echo. Okay, so you need to hear the. I know the women will be singing, but got to get you guys singing too now, all right? While by the sheep we watched at night, glad tidings brought an angel bright, how great our joy,
great our joy,
joy, joy, joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high.
Praise we the Lord in heaven on high.
There shall be born, so he did say, in Bethlehem a child today. How great our joy.
Great our joy.
Joy, joy, joy.
Joy, joy, joy.
Praise we the Lord in heaven. Heaven on high.
Praise we the Lord in heaven on high.
There shall the child lie in a stall. His
child who shall redeem us all. How great our joy!
Great our joy!
Joy, joy, joy!
Joy, joy, joy!
Praise we the Lord in heaven on high!
Praise we the Lord in heaven on high!
That every gift will cherish well, that every joy our heart shall fill. How great our joy!
Great our joy!
Joy, joy, joy!
Joy, joy, joy!
Praise ye the Lord in heaven on high!
Praise be the Lord in heaven on high!
All right. Finally, rejoice in the Lord always. We'll sing this through twice, and this will be our doxology.
Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice.
All right. Now the doxology. From Romans 16. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but has now been disclosed and through the prophetic writings has been made known to all nations, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, we will let Nichigo join us.